Don't buy another guitar. Get a gaming PC. Get a gaming PC.
But my quest needs to begin.
Three guitars equate to over $10,000.
Because I'm on a quest.
No, you don't need any more questing. Wait. Is it actually named Quest?
Yeah, it's called the Quest series. I'm not kidding. That's why it says Q. That the model name is like Q.
But why?
Because we're always on a quest for tone. And more guitars. Because we have an addiction. We all have an addiction.
It's a terrible name! You know what? You know the...
He's Goliath.
The one thing that Q makes sense in, do you see how many curves are on that stupid bitch? Look at it. You see how many curves are on that? Too many curves.
There's a lot of curves. Not the right kind of curves, though.
It also doesn't have the right angles.
Yeah, and we'll get to that, everybody. Because something interesting going on with these frets, in case you haven't noticed. So, as you're probably aware, this is Ibanez's modern headless guitar, because they've actually had a headless guitar in the past. As we know, that's currently not a production model.
They're really stretching the word modern. It's just a weird guitar. But the one thing that I think, you know, is the elephant in the room and everyone acknowledges, what the fuck are those frets, Ibanez?
Like, to be honest, I would have imagined this guitar would have been multi-scale. And this is actually the reason why when we first saw these leaks, almost a couple months ago, I think now, I kind of dismissed them as not being really authentic, because I was like, those frets look weird. It kind of looked like someone tried to Photoshop multi-scale and they didn't really know what a multi-scale kind of supposed to do. That's why I was like, oh, it's probably not real. But then now they've released a whole lineup. If you scroll down, and almost all these were actually models on those leaks. So we knew those leaks were actually real and the specs actually checked out. And to many surprise, they actually slanted the frets.
So what is the difference between the 52, 54, X52?
Yes, so...
What is all these?
So let's start with the first one. So the Q52, obviously a Quest, has a humbucker setup, regular 25.5-inch. And there are actually two different models for the Quest series. Different neck profiles, sorry.
Wait, they have two, what?
So, obviously they have roasted maple neck and fretboard. Maple neck has Babinga in it as well, so it's a three-piece. They do have Discard Evo gold fresh. It's pretty cool. At least they got something a little harder than nickel in there. So you see they mentioned here that they have a Wizard C neck. You know, it's a very generic description, not too thin, not too thick. You know, that's what everybody wants. This model here has what they call their Wizard C profile for this. Now, if we quickly just jump over to one of the Q54s, it has a parallel wizard neck.
Wait, what the fuck does that mean?
So, and this is kind of rather interesting. So, as you see in the beginning description, it has the same thickness all the way through. It is kind of interesting they kind of decided to go with two different neck profiles, and I don't really understand why they decided to do that.
Is that the only difference between the X and the no X?
And the slants and frets. So the models with the slants have this neck profile. But wait, actually, now that you zoomed in there, go back to those humbuckers there, because something interesting going on over there. You can kind of see there are three screws in there. I couldn't tell you why, to be honest, because you really only needed those two outer black ones.
It's really interesting because we have no fucking idea why they're there.
If somebody knows, comment down below, because I can't really see a reason why. I know like they have the two outer screws for some pick guards and stuff. But this one clearly does not have a pickguard, and it has a screw on there, even though it doesn't need it. Let's talk about this shape, actually. So, obviously, we kind of mentioned most people either love or hate the shape. It's kind of growing on me, but I think Ibanez could have done something cool with, like, maybe, like, an RGD body turned into headless. I think would have been really cool. Even a classic RG, it can't go wrong with that.
It kind of feels like they sat in a room and they said, how can we make a headless that looks different from everything else? And then someone put way more curves than you'd ever imagine. They just looked at the S series and they said,
cut that out.
Yeah, let's do that.
At least one curve I do kind of like is the one at the bottom horn. At least it kind of gives you nice clearance to get up there, but I don't think it was too necessary.
Does it also have a coil split?
So it has a similar layout to kind of like the AZs, where it's the kind of like a Dynamix setup. So it's pretty similar to what I'd say like the AZ kind of is, which, you know, it works. It's a lot of options, as you probably heard in our videos. If not, go check out our videos when we compare Ibanez AZs. but it's pretty versatile, you know, to get you on your quest for tone. So
you're probably gonna only use like three of these positions, and you're gonna like it. Oh, this has a 5-piece roasted maple Bubinga neck. Is that just because it's a 7-string?
Yes, I actually did not notice that until we looked at it right now. I kind of assumed it would have had the same neck profile as the other one. So now again, technically there's just three different necks going on.
Well, it's the same profile, but it's just five piece
instead of 3-piece. What I really like is the Poplar Burl top, as you know.
And the Niato body.
Yes.
Whatever the hell that means, it looks cool.
So, oh, yeah, headpiece, I think it looks really weird, but I think it's more functional, and I give Ibanez kind of props for this. Because one of the small issues you kind of run into most headless, at least, is that if you're using a fret wrap and, you know, you're muting your strings, you know, your nice little tappy, complicated part, everyone's, you know, really impressed. And you're like, all right, now time for me to gent. Let me just slide that off. Oh, no, I can't because there's nowhere to slide off to because the string locks are there. Ibanez has that extra space there between the actual string lock and the nut, so you can slide it back there and get those out of the way.
But how hard is it to make it look a little bit more aesthetically pleasing? You can have the extra area behind the nut without making it look like that. Like, at least you see Strandberg. Strandberg has like a nice little curve. They have the fretboard kind of follow in a very neat way along with the little curve that they give. But with Ibanez, same thing goes for Kiesel. Same thing goes, like, even Aristides does it, but like their whole aesthetic is very clean lines. So I don't give them as much crap about it.
Even the Ormsby.
Yeah, even Ormsby. But why can't any of them make it flow with the rest of the guitar? You see. Yeah. How many curves are on this guitar? So many curves are on this guitar, and then you have a square up here.
Yeah.
You have almost right angles up here.
It kind of looks like they added those little pieces on the side to give it a little thickness on the side, so you can at least maybe put it up on a hanger and not have to worry, because that's kind of one issue you kind of run into most headless, is because there's no headstock.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing for those hangers to grip onto, and then your guitar falls on the ground and you cry. Still, it looks really awkward. It kind of loses the flow of all the curves. So I definitely agree with you on that.
It feels like at the end they were like, let's chop off the headstock and just make it headless to make it more ergonomic.
It really does. Now that you say that, it really looks like it had a headstock design and you just chopped it off because of the straight edge. And they're like, all right, let's just chop it off a little and leave just enough space to put the Ibanez logo. Because you don't really see too many companies put the logo on the actual headstock nub. Usually they'll put it like where Strandberg kind of started doing down here. Or, you know, they do like Aristides has a little logo or something on the fretboard or something. If they did the nub a little better, it probably could have worked better. Mm-hmm. But it really does look like they just chopped it off.
You know, it's exciting always to see a new model out of a company, to see the new things that they're trying. So I'm curious as to how this would feel, how this would play, how everyone else and how you guys react to it. Honestly, my first instinct is that it's something, like, just altogether talking about the guitar. I think the headless, it's great that they're finally coming out with a headless model, but to come out with it in tandem with this weird 8-degree fan, not a fan, angled
slant,
slanted frets that they came out with, feels a little bit too much like they really want to tap a market that's looking for better ergonomics, to the point where you're going to angle the frets for maybe some niche techniques that certain genres like to use. I have no idea.
Math rock.
Math rock. I've never heard anyone complain that about the angle of the frets.
No.
I've never heard anyone say, like, the most I've ever heard was, like, you know, a multi-scale helps with, like, all-around playability. It seems like you're going to have a harder time hitting the high strings anytime you're playing below the 12th fret.
Yeah. Even though 8 degrees, it does sound, like, kind of small. And, of course, we're seeing it in the photo, so, like, in person, it probably won't feel as weird.
But it looks pretty dramatic.
But, that's the thing. I feel like in all the photos, it looks pretty dramatic. And so it's kind of hard to tell without playing. So maybe you might need to get one, so...
Uh-oh.
Like and subscribe if you want to see one.
I can't find my wallet. It's probably hiding for good reason.
I want to love this exact model, especially this 7-string with the Poplar Burl. It's almost right there, but had it been a multi-scale, yes. Mm-hmm. But a 25.5-inch 7-string, Like, come on.
Multi-scale headless would have been the perfect way to bring out this model. I think if they came out with a multi-scale headless, now you've got a headless and a multi-scale competing with Strandberg, competing with a ton of other companies that have taken it upon themselves to chop off the headstock, but keep the ergonomics of a fan fret. I feel like people are going to find it awkward between frets like 4 and 12. Like, yes. Maybe not so much around 9 to 12, but I feel like between 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, like, you're going to have some weird things happening with your fingers.
This is probably one of the ones I would have definitely jumped on. But again, it's the slant frets is what's keeping me away, and it's kind of hard to justify without really playing one. At least with a multi-scale, you know you have multiple benefits with it. Obviously, you have added tension and the ergonomic side of it as well. But this one seems like it's just trying to tack the ergonomic side. And if you scroll down to see the reasoning Ibanez gave, they're trying to aim it for a lot of people who are trying to do a lot of more like tapping finger style. So essentially like math raw kind of vibe going on there. And it's weird because it's not like Ibanez is opposed to using multi-skill or doesn't feel like venturing into that territory, because they've been using multi-skills for years now. They've had a 7 and 8 string for a couple years now. Now they started doing the headless with a multi-scale bass. Both concepts together, boom, test it out. People love the bass. And so it seemed like a natural progression. It's like, oh, they test it out on the bass. Bass players tend to be a little bit more progressive with these kind of ideas. Got some feedback. Now let's do a guitar.
Mm-hmm.
And then they kind of dropped the ball a bit. I don't know what happened, Ibanez. And I feel like this is definitely one of those highly anticipated models, but they kind of went a little bit in the wrong way, I think.
I look at this and I say, if I want to play a dominant 7 on the 3rd or 5th fret, or any fret between 5 and 8, or 5 and 9 even, my fingers are going to have to go backwards.
Yes.
And I don't like, it's already difficult to play one of those, like, regularly.
The slant makes sense after the 12th fret because that's kind of essentially the fan that happens on a multi-scale. But in this case, it's just a consistent angle. Basically, I'd say around the 9th and above, it just looks like things over there might be a little awkward. I would be more curious to see the artists that got these prototypes and who said, you know, this is a great idea, and like their thoughts behind
it. I mean, Ichika.
His is a straight scale, though, I'm pretty sure. Let's go check this out real quick. Yeah, his is a straight scale. Of any person, I feel like his would have made sense because, you know, he's kind of in that kind of genre that Ibanez is kind of describing of people who would use these kind of intricate, you know, techniques to, you know, execute more effectively. And his doesn't even have it.
In the description, it says, and I quote, "Highly technical and intricate techniques like tapping finger style and even occasional bass and slap riffs." And this...
insert riff from Ichika.
This is literally Ichika. Yeah. Like, this is him in a nutshell. That's exactly the kind of player that he is.
Yeah.
And he's not playing it. If this kind of guitar is marketed toward a guitar player like Ichika, and Ichika's not playing it, what was the reason? That's really what's baffling me.
Yeah, I'm wondering if it was more of an Ibanez corporate idea to go with it, or a player was like, you know, this would be kind of cool concept. That's one thing I feel like a multi-scale just would have made sense.
It would have made more sense. It would have made more sense for literally anyone who looks at Ibanez for reliable, modern guitars.
Yeah.
Especially headless ones, since they've been bursting popularity recently. And this was their chance. And I think that the angled frets, they're probably going to see a lot of sales in the Q52 and the Q54. And I don't think they're going to have a lot here. They're probably going to have a lot of sales because people are going to be curious. If people like the shape and they want the headless design, might as well go for these. And maybe, after seeing that, they might even come out with a 7-string version of the straight scale because, you know, it's still a headless. It's still nice in its own way, its own design. There's going to be people that just don't want these angled frets, especially for a 7-string. The angle only becomes more dramatic.
It really does.
When you add more strings.
It's very true.
You feel it more. Now the position of your fingers is going to be more dramatic between the 7th string and the 1st string than the 6th string and the 1st string. So adding that extra string actually makes it worse.
And I think like that's why you can see it a little bit more in here. Because here, like how you had it right there zoomed in, it looks very angled.
It looks super, because it's just going to keep traveling.
Exactly. And so you see the angle a little bit more. Same way, like how the same radius on, for example, six string versus a seven ray string.
Totally different.
The same radius, but it feels a little different because you have more space for that radius to occur.
And that's the same thing here. You have more space for the angled fret to travel. Therefore, you have a more dramatic shift between the seven string. Spread. You have more dramatic spread. Exactly. It might work for the six strings. I don't really understand how it's going to work for the seventh string. It's going to be really weird. And if we can get our hands on one, that would be wonderful for us to try and to review, to really see if it's really that big of a deal. We're making a big deal about it now because it looks very weird, and it's a big enough deal for them to produce. Yes. So we're going to make a big enough deal about it if it makes that real difference for people who like highly technical tapping riffs and all that stuff that their own artist Ichika decides not to implement that exact technology for.
I'm kind of curious because I feel like Ichika definitely helped Ibanez design these if he had his own signature, so he definitely had to play with a couple prototypes. So I'm assuming he probably had to play one with the slanted frets at some point, ideally, or some artists hopefully have played the prototype for those, because I'd be shocked if it didn't get in any artist's hand and they kind of just released that without really testing it, which doesn't seem like something Ibanez or any brand would really do.
You know, we would love to hear what everyone else thinks. We already know there's a bunch of videos out there that are already talking about this, but we really wanted to get our input out there because we think it's important to give everyone, including Ibanez, if they were ever to watch a video like this, how it feels when we see something like this, because it is very strange. And if we could get our hands on one, maybe it'll be a different story. But for now, this really feels like gimmicky technology. Yeah, I don't want to look at it. Like, I'll keep looking at him. I don't want to look at this anymore. But I'll keep looking at him. I'm cool with that.
Yeah. So I'm kind of curious, guys. What do you guys think of this model?
Let us know what you think. If you're going to be buying the guitar, if you're going to be reviewing the guitar, give us your thoughts on it, please. Because, you know, I like Ibanez. I love Ibanez as a company. I own two guitars, one of them being a Prestige from Ibanez. I want this to be something revolutionary. If it is revolutionary, but if it just feels like a gimmick, I don't want to pay for a gimmick, and I don't want anyone else to need to pay for a gimmick. It just doesn't feel right. Please, if you're so gracious and enjoy the content, we do have a Patreon. If you would like to support us in more ways than just following, subscribing, commenting, liking, like, all that's enough. Patreon would be going way above and beyond, but we appreciate every single response we get. All right, catch you in the next video.
See you guys.
Peace out.
Hey, you're the one.